Dear students, in this video lecture, I shall be describing about indications of tracheostomy, types of tracheostomy, different tracheostomy tubes, and steps of tracheostomy surgery. Please watch Tracheostomy 2 for complications and recent advances. How do you define tracheostomy? Tracheostomy is defined as a surgical procedure to create an opening through the neck into the trachea. This is synonymous with tracheotomy. Tracheostomy is the procedure and tracheotomy is the process of making a hole in the trachea. Therefore, tracheostomy is better name than the tracheotomy. Coming to history of tracheostomy, tracheostomy has passed through different periods. The first one was period of legend from 2000 BC to 1546 AD. During those times, tracheostomy used to be there, mention of tracheostomy in Egyptian mummies. Second period is period of fear from 1546 to 1833. During that time, most of the surgeons used to fear to do tracheostomy and surgery was performed by few braves, often at the risk of their reputation. So, this period was not very fruitful for tracheostomy. There was fear for tracheostomy surgery. Then came the period of dramatization. When the patient having acute respiratory distress gets relieved of airway obstruction and can breathe easily, then that will be a drama, and that happened to be during that time. Next comes period of enthusiasm from 1932 to 1965. It was enthusiastic time to perform tracheostomy, and if a surgeon used to think of tracheostomy, they could perform tracheostomy. From 1965 till now is the period of rationalization. Tracheostomy is performed in a rational way. The surgeon weighs the merits and demerits of tracheostomy versus intubation. If the surgeon feels that tracheostomy has to be performed, then he or she will perform tracheostomy. Now let's discuss about indications of tracheostomy. The most common indication for tracheostomy is upper airway obstruction. There are different causes of upper airway obstruction. They are congenital anomalies like laryngeal wave, cyst, coronary atresia, infective or inflammatory conditions like acute epiglottitis, croup, deep neck space infections or abscesses, edema due to irritation, irradiation or allergy. Next is trauma to the airway, might be external trauma or endoscopic trauma. External trauma is more common than endoscopic trauma. External trauma in the form of road traffic accidents, physical assaults might happen. Neoplastic conditions like laryngotracheal or pharyngeal malignancies might cause obstruction of the upper airway, foreign body in the upper airway, or bilateral abdominal paralysis when the patient cannot abduct their vocal cords, then they are the indications for tracheostomy. Chronic aspiration in cases of bilateral abdominal paralysis also can be an indication for tracheostomy. Second indication is respiratory insufficiency in conditions like chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, atelectasis, retained airway secretions. They all might lead to respiratory insufficiency, and if you do tracheostomy, the patient can breathe through the tracheostomy. Third is retained secretions in the airway, inability to cough out the sputum like coma, respiratory muscle palsy or spasm, laryngectomy, then painful cough in conditions like chest injuries and pneumonia. There will be retained secretions in the airway. Excessive secretions in conditions like pulmonary edema also might lead to retained secretions. Next indication for tracheostomy is anesthesia administration in laryngopharyngeal growth, maxillofacial trauma, trismus when the patient cannot open the mouth, severe ludic angina when there is obstruction of the upper airway, and positive pressure ventilation for more than 72 hours. In those conditions, we can do elective tracheostomy. What are different types of tracheostomy? They are emergency or elective tracheostomy. As already told, when the patient is having acute upper airway obstruction, patient needs emergency tracheostomy. But when the patient is undergoing surgery for oral or oropharyngeal lesions, then we can perform elective tracheostomy. Tracheostomy might be temporary or permanent. When we perform tracheostomy, the upper airway obstruction might return back, then that is temporary. Suppose when the patient has to undergo laryngectomy, then that surgery will be permanent tracheostomy. Tracheostomy can also be performed as a part of therapeutic procedures or prophylactic procedures like Impending upper airway obstruction is prophylactic and therapeutic when there is upper airway obstruction. Tracheostomy can also be divided as the level of tracheal opening or stoma made. High tracheostomy in the first ring or above the thyroid isthmus, usually performed in carcinoma larynx. When the patient has to undergo total laryngectomy, then for that we require high tracheostomy. Mid tracheostomy between second to third ring of the trachea behind thyroid isthmus is the most commonly performed surgery. Stoma is most commonly made here as the standard routine, and low tracheostomy is the stoma is made below the fourth ring, below thyroid isthmus. Usually we can do for big thyroid tumors, but we should avoid doing either a very high or very low tracheostomy. Mid tracheostomy is the commonly performed surgery. High tracheostomy leads to subglottic stenosis, so it is better to avoid high tracheostomy. And low tracheostomy is avoided as trachea is deeper as it goes down. There are more chances of displacement of tracheostomy tube when the stoma is lower down. As the trachea goes down, it is in more proximity to the great vessels, so there is high chance of injury of great vessels. As the stoma is near the lung apex, there might be surgical emphysema. The tracheostomy stoma is close to tracheal bifurcation, so sometimes air entry might be in one lung, leading to collapse of the opposite lung. Let's come to commonly used tracheostomy tubes. We can divide the tracheostomy tubes into metallic and plastic tubes or polyvinyl chloride tubes. Let's discuss about metallic tracheostomy tubes first. First is Jackson's metallic tracheostomy tube. This is the Jackson's metallic tracheostomy tube that is made up of good quality stainless steel. It has obturator. This is the obturator. This is the inner tube and this is the outer tube. Inner tube is longer than the outer tube because the crust should be collected in the tip of the inner tube. The inner tube can be removed, cleaned and reinserted, so there is no need for frequent suction when we use the inner tube. Outer tube basically maintains the patency of the stoma. Therefore, the inner tube has to be taken time by time for cleaning purpose. If the inner tube is slightly longer, then the crust collects in the inner tube and we can remove and we can clean the inner tube. There is advantage of inner tube being slightly longer than the outer tube. This can be asked in MCQs or in the Viva. The outer tube maintains the patency of the stoma. The outer tube should not be removed time by time. There is an obturator which is inserted into the outer tube for a smooth and non-traumatic insertion of the tube. You can see here, this is the outer tube having flanges and this is the obturator being put in the outer tube. So this will make an easy way for insertion purpose without trauma. The outer tube has a lock mechanism for the inner tube and it is used for protection of the inner tube during coughing. So there is support from the outer tube to the inner tube as in the form of a lock. This is the lock and this is the place to lock for the inner tube. So the inner tube is locked from the outer tube. So by this lock mechanism, the inner tube does not get displaced when the patient coughs. Next is Fuller's bivalved metallic tracheostomy tube. It is made up of German silver containing copper plus zinc plus nickel. It is more malleable than the Jackson's metallic tube. You can see here, it is bivalved and it's malleable. The two blades, when pressed together, they help in smooth entry of the tube. So we don't require an extra obturator. Again, the inner tube is longer and has a bend for phonation. This is the bend for phonation that is lacking in Jackson's tracheostomy tube. When the patient closes the main tube opening here, the patient can phonate. Suppose if there is laryngeal airway, then patient can phonate through the inner tube opening. Okay. The bend also helps in decannulation of tube. During decannulation, the outer part of the tube is closed and patient can breathe from here towards the larynx and from the nose. This is the advantage of Fuller's tracheostomy tube over Jackson's tracheostomy tube. Now let's come to Portex cough tracheostomy tube. We have discussed two metallic tubes. Portex cough tube is made up of siliconized polyvinyl chloride. This is thermolabile and it prevents crusting. This is important. Being thermolabile, while inserting, is slightly stiff and while it goes inside the body, the tracheostomy tube becomes more malleable and softer. It is a cough tube, therefore it can be used as the first tube during tracheostomy. This can be used during positive pressure ventilation and this also prevents aspiration of the secretions. This provides airtight seal for the ventilation purpose also. The outer part contains 15 mm to be fitted in the ventilators. Now coming to some modifications, as we saw in conventional tracheostomy tube, the polyvinyl tube or the plastic tube doesn't have the inner tube. But the modifications is the cuffed double lumen tube are available. These are cuffed fenestrated tube. We saw that the polyvinyl tube was not fenestrated, and you can see fenestrated tube here. Again, it helps in decondition and breathing purpose and speaking purpose also. Cuffed fenestrated tube helps in phonation, and during decondition we can close the outer part. Protex also can be uncuffed. The children have the weak tracheal rings, so there might be chance of tracheal necrosis when the children are used with the cuffed tube. So uncuffed tube can be used in children and for patients receiving irradiation. There can be uncuffed double lumen fenestrated tube also. This is fenestrated tube, so this is double lumen fenestrated tube. This also can be used for ventilation purpose and for phonation purpose. There are tubes called as hands-free speaking tube. As we saw in Fuller's tracheostomy tube, when the patient closes the outer tube, then patient can speak. But in the hands-free speaking bulb tube, this is the bulb, gets closed during expiration. Therefore, the patient can speak through the mouth when there is minimal airway also. For obese patients and patients having edematous neck, we can use tubes with adjustable flange, because in obese patients, as you know, there is very high chance of ill-fitting tracheostomy or there might be displaced tracheostomy tubes. To avoid that, we can use tracheostomy tube with adjustable flange. Double cuff tracheostomy tube, as you see here, prevents ischemic necrosis of tracheal cartilage, so can be used in children or can be used in people whose trachea is weak. But nowadays, the tracheostomy tubes come with high volume, low pressure cuff. Therefore, there is very less chance of tracheal injuries in long term also. Let's differentiate between metal and the plastic tracheostomy tubes. The metal tubes can be easily cleaned without suction because they have inner tube and the outer tube. The inner tube can be removed and can be cleaned time by time without use of suction. Plastic tubes have only one tube. Cleaning requires suction. In metal tubes, the cuff is absent, and in plastic tubes, the cuff is present. Therefore, plastic tubes can be connected with the ventilator, and metal tubes cannot be connected with the ventilator. Metal tubes are rigid and they are less comfortable to the patient. Plastic tubes, as they are malleable and they are thermolabile, they are soft and they are more comfortable for the patient. The most commonly used tracheostomy tube by us is Protex tracheostomy tube, having a single lumen. Concomitant radiotherapy is to be avoided in metal tubes. As you know, the metal tubes observe the radiation and plastic tubes don't observe radiation, so radiation therapy can be given. While using radiation, uncuffed tracheostomy tube is better used. Let's come to different tracheostomy tubes to be used according to age of the patient. In children from 1 to 3 years, the Protex tube is used as the inner diameter 4 to 4.5 millimeters and metal tube of 16 flange. You should be clear that the Protex tracheostomy tube 4 size is equivalent to metal tracheostomy tube 16 size, that is 1:4. In 4 to 6 years, the Protex tube 5 inner diameter, metal tube 18 to 20, 5 into 4 equals 20, 7 to 9 years, Protex 5.5 and metal 20 to 22, 10 to 12 years, Protex 6 and metal 24 to 26, from 13 to 18 years, Protex 7 to 7.5 and metal 20 to 30. In adults, the commonly used tube size is Protex 7.5 to 8 and metal from 30 to 32, but when the patient is obese or when the patient is very fat, then you can use slightly bigger size tubes. Let's come to the steps of tracheostomy. First, patient position has to be the supine position with extension of neck by keeping a sandbag behind the shoulder blades. This is extended neck and there is a sandbag behind the shoulder blades so that there should be adequate neck extension. Antiseptic dressing and draping is performed, and surgery can be either performed under local anesthesia when the patient is having acute respiratory distress and when the patient cannot be intubated, or general anesthesia with endotracheal intubation or simply sedation. When the patient is already intubated, then we can give general anesthesia, or patient can simply be sedated and tracheostomy can be performed. The second step is infiltration. The cricoid is palpated and a 5 cm horizontal incision line is marked 2 cm below the cricoid, between the cricoid and the suprasternal notch. 2% lignocaine with 1 in 200,000 adrenaline is injected in the incision line. Now, a 5 cm horizontal incision is made with number 15 blade and it is deepened below the subcutaneous tissue. Alternatively, a 5 cm midline vertical incision can be made below the cricoid in emergency to avoid injury to blood vessels. We usually perform tracheostomy by midline vertical incision. there will be decreased bleeding and we can palpate the midline. So the dictum during tracheostomy surgery is you should not leave the midline and you should palpate the trachea time by time. Now we have to expose the strap muscles. Investing layer of deep spiral fascia is opened vertically with artery forceps to expose the strap muscles. Now comes the exposure of thyroid isthmus. The strap muscles are retracted laterally with Langenbeck retractors to expose the thyroid isthmus and the trachea. Once you expose the thyroid isthmus, you can see trachea just deeper to it. Never forget to palpate in every step. Now, the isthmus has to be separated from the trachea. There are different techniques. Some people detach thyroid isthmus from tracheal surface and retract it with the blunt tracheal hook. This is the thyroid which is retracted up with the tracheal hook. Sometimes the thyroid isthmus can be divided between clamps. Here, thyroid isthmus has been divided between the clamps and transfixing sutures are applied at the ends. Now, the trachea is to be confirmed. How to confirm the trachea? Take a 5 ml syringe containing 4% lidocaine, insert the needle into the trachea and aspirate. If air bubbles come in the syringe, it is confirmed that our needle is in the trachea. But always try to palpate in the midline to confirm the trachea. Now, 2 ml of this solution is injected into the trachea for topical anesthesia to avoid violent cough. Because if the patient wakes up or if the surgery is performed under local anesthesia, then patient will have severe violent cough once you enter the trachea and you suction there. Now, this is the most important step of surgery, creation of tracheal window. A cricoid hook is inserted below the cricoid to steady the trachea, and the tracheal window can be created by excising the anterior 1/3 of second and third tracheal rings or third and fourth tracheal rings with number 11 blades and held with edge tissue forceps. This is what the surgeon is doing here. This is a tracheal ring where the cord has been there. This is probably second and third. There are other different techniques of tracheal incisions. You can apply T technique, box shape, gut shape, cruciate or U shape, or you can simply remove the part of the tracheal ring out. Especially in children, you can make a jerk flap. There is an inferiority based flap which can be sutured here. This is a suture. And you can make a flap so that there will be good opening of the trachea. And alternatively, the stay sutures are to be placed between the tracheal rings. These are the stay sutures to stabilize the trachea. And these sutures should be kept outside the wound so that these sutures can be lifted up and you can see the tracheal opening. Now, once you have opened the trachea, then you have to insert the tracheostomy tube. So first, you have to suction in the trachea. Then you can see the endotracheal tube if it is already kept. And ask the anesthesiologist to withdraw the endotracheal tube towards the larynx. Then a lubricated tracheostomy tube is inserted into the trachea under guidance. That is very important. Sometimes if there is no guidance, the tracheostomy tube might go into the false tract and patient can die also. You have to always confirm the presence of tube in the trachea with the help of ambu bag and auscultation. So there should be adequate urine. Then only you have to fix the tracheostomy tube. Now, once you are sure that the tracheostomy tube is in place, now you have to suture the flanges. Now the cuff is inflated with 5 ml of air and anesthetic circuit connected to the tube. Patient has to be ventilated now. The neck extension is to be released and flanges of the tube are sutured to skin to avoid the tube movement. So we can suture the flanges with the skin to make the tube fix. And the tapes are to be tied around the neck, keeping a space for at least one finger, and the neck is slightly flexed. So if you keep one finger, the tape will not be tight. Then the skin incision is closed loosely to avoid surgical emphysema. If the skin incision is closed very tightly, the patient might develop surgical emphysema. Now at last, we have to insert the medicated gauze or betadine soaked gauze or sofratuli around the tracheostomy opening. Here you can see the medicated gauze, and this is the medicated gauze which is kept between the skin and the tracheostomy tube so that there will be no irritation by the tracheostomy tube to the skin. The opening of the tube should be covered with a single layer of wet gauze piece. This is the opening which should be covered with a single layer of wet gauze piece, because when the patient breathes in, now there will be dry air going towards the trachea and the bronchi. That will lead to dryness and patient will have violent cough at least for a few days. Therefore, we have to keep a single layer of wet gauze piece that helps in slight moistening of the air. And this finishes the steps of tracheostomy. Please watch the next video for complications of tracheostomy and recent advances like percutaneous tracheostomy, cricothyroidectomy or mini tracheostomy. Thank you.